Well, good morning, First Church. It is so good to be with you here this morning at the start of our brand new series. And my name is Pastor John. I'm the senior pastor here. Some of you are probably thinking that I'm a 15-year-old from Saigon. You're like, is he old enough to drive? And it's hard to tell with Asian people how old we actually are, and I won't tell you. But look, if you're new here, I just want you to know that we're so glad to have you. My wife and I have been here for 2 years, and we have just loved this church. We've been blown away just by the loving community that we found in this place. And we've never found a more loving, accepting, and caring, and generous community than First Church. And if you're looking for a place with real people who care for you, a place maybe to build connection and raise a family, I can't think of a better place than right here. And we would love to have you be a part of our family. Now, this series called We Can Be Better Together is primarily targeted at couples, but it's going to have a lot for people who are single, people who are looking to see relationships with parents, siblings, in-laws, all kinds of people become better. And I just want to acknowledge, if you're here today and you're dealing with a divorce, or maybe you are a widow or you are a widower, I know that things like this can be painful. But I want you to know that there is going to be good things for you in this series. And I just want you to know that we love you. We're so glad that you're here. And we remember your pain. But more significantly, I really believe that Jesus loves for you and cares for you in the midst of your pain. Now, I know there's some of you here today who would say, we can be better together? Come on. My relationship is what it is, Pastor. We've been married for longer than you've been alive. You know, I mean, come on. Like, I've just kind of grieved what my marriage isn't and accepted who he is, and it's all right. You know, the best I can say about marriage is it's a shoulder shrug, you know? So don't try and tell me that we can be better together, because it's about as good as it's going to get, and it's okay. You know, it's all right. It's vanilla. It's Nebraska, kind of. You know, I mean, it is what it is. There's some of you here today who say, Pastor, our marriage is actually, it's pretty decent. You know, and there's others of you who would say, don't even tell me that it can get better, because it can't. It's terrible, and it will never get better. We have the worst, and I'm just leaving my spouse. Don't try and talk me out of it. And to all of you, I would say, in the name of Jesus, I believe your relationships can be better together. And I really believe that God has this incredible process and plan for relationships, all relationships, that can make you better together. And that's really what I want to focus on today. I want to talk about this plan that God has for our marriages. And here's the thing. The current statistics on marriage are pretty staggering, okay? We have more than 50% of marriages ending in divorce. And the younger you are, especially if you're part of my generation, the millennial generation, you're even more likely to get divorced. And the sad part about it is, researchers have found that most of the marriages, and I do mean most of the marriages that do endure, do exactly that. They endure. They don't enjoy. And I just would wonder, what other area of your life are you okay with a 50% fail rate? You know, if your vehicle broke down 50% of the time you used it, I think you'd say, well, this is ridiculous. I shouldn't have bought a Fiat, right? I mean, come on. You know, or if there was a restaurant that you went to that had 50% food poisoning, you know, every time you'd go there, you'd be like, well, this is a terrible idea. I'm not going to eat here anymore. If there was an airline that had 50% of its flights crash and burn, we would say, hey, no, that's probably a bad idea. But with marriage, we're okay with a 50% shot. Or worse, right? It's just a flip of the coin. And we're okay with that. And I know there's some of you here who say, Pastor, our love is legend, okay? We are meant to be. I mean, we're an exception to the rule. But here's the thing. Why would you be an exception to the rule if you do everything that secular society does relationally, you know? You date around, you sleep around. You know, get together before you together, and you get married, and you think, oh, yeah, my relationship is going to be different. I mean, last time I checked, if you want something to be different, you need to do something different. And this is why I love Jesus' plan for marriage, because it is so radically different. And the thing is, he's actually staggeringly successful. This week, I want to talk about a Christ-centered relationship, and I know there's some of you here who are like, ugh, dogma. It's dogma. It's religion. It's ritual. I'm going to cross my arms and I'm going to zone out because my wife twisted the guilt gun and brought me here at shotgun point, okay? I can't do it. She put the hollow point in there and said, you better get to church, right? And here's the thing. I'm not speaking just because of dogma. I do believe that Jesus has the best plan, but I'm not going to say just because the Bible tells me so. I think that Jesus has revolutionized relationships. I believe that he primarily came to earth to restore relationships between God and man and each other. That's what Jesus came to do. I think he's an expert on relationships. And some of you are like, come on, please, he was never married. What does he know about women? Unless Dan Brown and Da Vinci Code was right. I believe that Jesus has a lot to say about relationships. 2,000 years ago, Jesus taught about this new paradigm of relationship that was laughable to the rest of the world. People heard what Jesus taught, and they were like, ha, are you kidding me? That'll never work. And here's the thing. I don't know if you know this, but statistically, people who follow the teachings of Jesus have a dramatically lower divorce rate. I know there's some of you here who'd be like, well, excuse me, Pastor, I've actually read a study. And I'm glad that you brought up the Barna study that was conducted from 20 years ago. 20 years ago, the Barna Group released a study which said that Christians get divorced at the same rate as non-Christians. And that study was conducted by calling, cold calling, thousands of different couples and asking them, do you identify as Jewish, Muslim, Christian, or other? Those were the four options that they were given. And the vast majority of the respondents in that survey said, I identify as Christian. But what I've begun to realize is there's a pretty big difference between identifying as Christian and following the teachings of Jesus, following the ways of Jesus. Because I'll be honest, I know lots of people who would identify as Christian, but they're like, well, yeah, I don't go to church, read my Bible, follow God's plan for my life. I mean, Jesus Christ is a swear word, but I mean, that's about it for me. That's about the only thing that I do. But I identify as Christian. There's a big difference between those two things. And recently, a bevy of studies have been conducted which actually look at people who follow the teachings of Jesus and what the divorce rates are among that group. And a recent Family Life Research Institute survey conducted among thousands of couples found that fewer than 8% of couples will pray together out loud regularly in the name of Jesus. Now, I think that's pretty significant because if you and your spouse pray together out loud in the name of Jesus, I think it's very likely that you're going to be following Jesus in other areas of your life. Right? That would be, if you're doing that, doesn't necessarily mean that. But if you're praying together out loud in the name of Jesus regularly, it's probably very likely that you'll be following Jesus. And of those 8%, this is crazy, they found that fewer than 1% of those couples would end up divorced, which means the marital success rate among couples who pray together out loud in the name of Jesus is 99%. Okay, that's astonishing. If you are a researcher and you see those statistics, your head would explode and you'd just be dead. It would just be the end. I mean, that is so many standard deviations beyond statistically significant. It's like, that's miraculous. It's miraculous. The idea that one subsect of people with only one thing in common, that they pray together out loud regularly in the name of Jesus, that their marriage success rates would be so incredibly much higher. That's astonishing. Now, when Kristen and I got married, I'll be honest, praying together out loud regularly in the name of Jesus was super awkward for us. And we're like, oh, okay. Well, we get to hold hands. That's fantastic. And we'd pray together. But God has really blessed our marriage and our intimacy because of praying together out loud regularly in the name of Jesus. And I actually think this is one of the many different reasons why we shouldn't date people who don't follow Jesus. I'm not saying you can't be friends with people who don't follow Jesus, but if you're here today and you're dating someone who doesn't follow Jesus, Jesus says, date other Christians, not people who identify as Christian, not people who say, yeah, I'll go to church with you if you want. I mean, I identify as Christian, but people who actually love Jesus because he wants you to experience this benefit and blessing. And if you're a non-Christian and you're here today and you're dating somebody who's a Christian who brought you here at gunpoint, I promise you they're going to bait and switch you. When you get married, they're going to say, oh yeah, you need to come to church all the time and, you know, I want to raise our kids to love Jesus. So just do yourself a favor and break up with them right now because you're going to get bait and switched, I promise. It'll happen. Other studies show that couples who regularly attend church and honor God's plan for biblical marriage profess higher satisfaction with sex life. Awesome. Booyah. Dramatically lower divorce rates. And higher levels of satisfaction with life and higher levels of personal joy. And this is phenomenal. Specifically, people who follow Jesus's plan and purpose for life. I think it's like, man, people spend thousands of dollars on spas and shrinks and all this other stuff. And like, you can have this incredible, incredible life by following Jesus. And I think there's so many of us here who would cross our arms and be like, oh, it's church, it's Jesus. I mean, come on, pastor, give me something that's useful. In light of all these things, those of you who are skeptics, would you just open your heart to the idea there's something about Jesus' plan for relationship? I'm just asking you, before we jump into today's message, would you just consider with me the idea, the possibility that there could be something to Jesus and his teachings? I don't think we can ignore these statistics, and I'm not just asking you to accept it because the Bible says so. I'm asking you to consider this because the reality of the world that we live in clearly says so. And I'm asking you to commit to coming to church for the next 5 weeks. The next 5 weeks. I try not to write sermons as like a 1 week package. I try to write 5 weeks of message as one big long message, and I split it up. And so what I don't want you to do is say, well, I'll come this one time, and then, oh, God's plan didn't work for my life. No. I want to give you 5 weeks. Give me 5 weeks to unfold God's plan for relationships. And worst case scenario, you leave here and you're like, well, I'm not better together. And that's fine. Never come back if you don't. That's it. But if you lean into what we're teaching here and your relationship is blessed, maybe you could give Jesus a chance. We're going to jump into a key passage today, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21. And I'm going to give you guys three foundational points that are going to be critical for the rest of this series, this five-week series. I'm going to give you 3 points that Jesus teaches about relationships. But before we do that, I just want to invite God into this message with a prayer. So, true Lord Jesus, we just invite you into this room. We just invite your Holy Spirit to be present here. We ask that you would open up our minds and hearts. We just believe that you are who you say you are and that you can do what you say you can do. I just ask that you would transform people's lives and eternities and relationships because of what we're talking about today. Please speak through me. And Lord, if I say anything that's not of your will and word, I just ask that everybody would just forget it right away. But if I say your truth, I ask that it would transform the way we live. In the name of Jesus, the risen Savior, all God's people said, amen. Amen. So 3 points about relationship. Let's take a look at 2 Corinthians 5, verse 16, okay? Here's how it starts out. Got it. Okay, so we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. Have you ever been in an evaluating relationship where you just kind of evaluate? Some of you, you know, you evaluate your spouse constantly. You know, you got the scoreboard, you keep it up, evaluating others. It's a really functional way to do relationships. I've done that before. I love competition, especially in marriage. Just kidding. Okay, at one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now. And the point that I really synthesize from this is simple. Jesus teaches us to fight for, not against, one another. I think Jesus in our relationships teaches us to fight for, not against, one another. And here's the thing. I think a lot of times we have difficulty putting our spouse's best interest first. I think it's usually our best interest that we put first. And what we do in relationship is we end up taking all kinds of rocks and we, you know, proverbial rocks, and we throw them at each other to protect ourselves. We say, man, she's going to score on me, and before I let her do that, I'm gonna take an early strike at her. I'm going to make sure that I protect myself and that I get mine. I got to make sure that she doesn't get me more than I get her because I got to win. I got to protect myself because we live in a finite world. We live in a world of scarcity. I have to make sure that I get mine. That's a human point of view, right? We evaluate, we keep score, we make sure that we're winning, we make sure that we hurt them more than they hurt us. And that's the way that Paul used to look at Jesus. The author of this passage used to look at Jesus. But then he realized that Jesus was more than human. Jesus rose from the dead. So he wasn't just fully man. We believe that Jesus was God. And that's this thing, like Jesus conquered the grave, and all of a sudden, they realized, man, like, there's more than this life. Like, Jesus promises us this eternity beyond this life. And so instead of struggling and worrying about getting mine, I believe that Jesus has already given me more than I could ask for or imagine. I have exceedingly abundantly more than I could ever need. So I'm not so worried about scoring on the other person. You know what? I've already got more than I need. I'm going to give my life away. I want to ask you, how would your relationships changed if you considered your spouse's needs ahead of your own? If you said, I want to fight for them. I want to help them become all that God has for them. In our household, my wife and I, she would say that we've been having conversations. That's what women always say. I would say that we've been fighting fiercely, okay? But we've been fighting about having a fourth child. We're not pregnant, okay? But we've been fighting about, do we want to have another child? I recognize that the Lord opens and closes the womb. I also recognize that two kids, one kid was plenty for me, okay? Now we have three, and we're talking about having a fourth. And there have been some intense, heated conversations, you know. I felt a little bit guilty because I dragged her across the country from the only town she's ever lived in to move here to pursue my hopes and dreams. And her only hope and dream is to become a mommy, you know. And it's like, oh my goodness, wow, I don't want to deprive her of that, but I've already, you know, and we've been talking. And she eventually came to me the other day, and she said, John, I love you so much. I'm fine with three kids, if that's what you want. I care about you. I don't want you to dread coming home. If three kids is what you want, then that's what we can do. Go to the doctor. And, you know, make an appointment and have him, you know, cut the fuel lines and we're good, okay? I shouldn't have said that. Anyway, that was just, we had the conversation. That's where it went. So I regret that. We'll use second service for sure. But she said that, and I realized, oh my goodness, my wife is fighting for me. She's not worried about getting hers. It transformed our marriage because she looked at me and she said, I care about you and your desires and your health. And consequently, I really believe that the Lord changed my heart. And I said, okay, well, if you can't keep your hands off me, then we'll have another kid. You know, that's the way it's going to go. It's the Better Together series, guys. We're gonna have some innuendo. How would your marriage change if you looked at your spouse and said, you know what, I don't want to fight against you. I want to fight for you. I want to help you become all that God has for you. And that's just really my number one goal. As you look at your wife, your husband, and you say, I want to fight for you. You look at your sibling, you look at your mother-in-law, you look at whoever's in your life, and you say, I want to fight for you. I'm not worried about getting mine. God has already given me more than I could ask for or imagine. The next verse in the passage gives us a second beautiful point. It says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old is gone. The new life has begun. And I think this is this beautiful passage. And what Paul is talking about here, he's saying Jesus teaches us to look at potential, not at problems. Jesus says, hey, I'm not worried about the mistakes of your past. I'm worried about helping you step into your future. And this is a beautiful way to do relationship. You know, when my wife and I got married, we had very different ideas about domestic things. And we had some conversations. You know, again, guys, we call that fights. Girls, we call that conversations. But we had conversations about how much I was contributing to the domestic, you know, household. And I don't think it's that I was lazy. It's just that I had a much higher tolerance. I was far more patient, we'll call it, with domestic disarray. Okay, we don't need to do the dishes because there's a few dishes in the sink. Let's wait till the pile is good and tall. We don't need to do the laundry yet. Honey, I have many stages of clothing dirtiness. Okay, you got to understand. It's really more of a spectrum, and this is in the middle of the spectrum. I'd hate to waste all that water and energy and everything else. I just care about the environment, honey. We don't need to do anything yet. Let's let the pile get a little bigger, and then we'll do it. But she was like, hey, look, there's half load, quarter of a load. Perfect, throw it in. And so it wasn't that I was lazy. It's just that my threshold, my tolerance of dirtiness was never reached, right? Well, anyway, so she spoke to me a few times, and, you know, in that tone that let me know that, you know, she's not happy with me. I will call it criticism. I mean, that's what it was. And then I remember one day, I vividly remember this, in Elk River, in her house in Elk River, Minnesota, she said to me, you know, John, I just find it so attractive. It's kind of hot. It's kind of sexy when you do the dishes. And I said, what? Turn down for what? I'll do this. So I've done the dishes in our house. That's what I do. I load the dishwasher. I do it all. I wipe down counters. I mean, it used to be crumbs on counters is fine. But now, like, I'm wiping down counters. I'm doing all this stuff because she called out potential in me. You understand? She looked at me and she said, look, I'm not worried about who you've been in the past, but I want to help you become something better in the future. I want to call out potential. I want to speak in encouragement. And it has transformed our relationship. And I want you to know that this is the way Jesus looks at you. He doesn't look at your past and say, oh, you've blown it. You're a screw-up. You've been divorced? Well, you've got a scarlet letter on your life. You know, you went to prison once, it's over. You know, you've messed up in this way your life. No, he looks at your potential and he says, I can't wait to see what you're going to become. I have so much for your future. Can you imagine how your relationship would be transformed? Now, my issue with this, both these points, fight for, not against, Jesus sees potential, not problems, is that I have a really hard time activating these in my life consistently. If you're like me, you hear pastor talking about it, and you're like, oh, yeah, that's great, but I'll never be able to do that. I can't. And here's what I love about this next passage. It says, and all of this is a gift from God. Who's it from? It's a gift from God. And I think so often what we do is we hear these good points. We hear these motivational speakers, and you just got to find it within yourself. Transform your marriage. Get the marriage you always wanted with these two easy steps. And it's like, it ain't that easy. It's not that easy. I mean, I try, but it's not that easy. And I think so often what we forget is that there is a higher power, okay, who stands above us and before us, who wants to give us this free gift. It's something that he equips us with. And before I was a follower of Jesus, I didn't understand it. I thought I'd white-knuckle it through this. But no. The ability to live in grace and selflessness with the people around you that you love, it is a gift from God. And this is one of the most astonishing things I found about Christians when I was a non-Christian. I thought, really? You just live in grace? You just consider others better than yourself? How would you do that? But when I gave my life to Jesus, I really saw a transformation. It says, who brought us back to himself through Christ. This is just saying he is in the business of restoring broken relationships, specifically broken relationships between us and God. And here's my third point, and this activates the other 2 points. This is the foundation of the first 2 points. It's that Jesus restores relationships through forgiveness. I really believe that this is how Jesus works. He restores relationships through forgiveness. I'll illustrate this to you in a different way. Christy, can you come up on stage real quick? I need you to come up here, honey. I'll pull you up. Can you do the big step? This is good. I'll pull you up. No, you got it. Neil? Okay. That's good. You guys, this is my wife, Kristen. She's the best, okay? True story. I saw her, and before I knew her name, I knew that I was going to marry her. I did. It's true. You can ask family members. I said, I met the woman I'm going to marry. What's her name? I don't know, but I'm going to marry her. And we did. We got married. Kristen, I want you to just take this rock, okay? Hold on to this. Now, my wife, most people don't know this about Kristen, and this is why I love playing sports with her on my team, because she is such a fierce competitor, and she's a stunning athlete. She went to a huge, huge school. She had 1,000 kids in your class, over 1,000. She's the captain of the women's soccer team. She's extremely aggressive. She's a dark horse. So if she actually throws this foot at my rock, she's going to break my, or at my, throws that rock at my foot, she's going to break, forget about it, guys. Second service, like I said. She's going to break the bones in my foot, right? Now, I don't actually want you to do it, but pretend. I want you to pretend to throw that rock, that rock in my foot, you know, just break. So let's pretend that she does that, right? And you can just see she just can be vicious, right? You try arguing with her. It's devastating. But so she argues, she breaks my foot. She says, I'm leaving you. It's over, right? And I sent out a prayer request to the church, you know, guys, please pray for my foot. My wife viciously broke it. She left me, you know, and you guys all come visit me in the hospital. You know, the doctors come and say to me, you know, Pastor, we did everything we could, but we had to amputate your foot, you know, and so I've lost my foot, and you guys come, you visit me, and I just show you the rock, right? I say, this is the rock that Kristen used to cut my foot off. I mean, this is the pointy end that just actually shattered the bones in my foot, and I could show everybody this rock, couldn't I? I could say, this is what she did. Can you believe that she did this to me? That she broke my foot? I could show everybody this rock. And what I could do is after everybody left, I could just kind of hold it close and fantasize about what a jerk my wife is. Have you ever done that? Where you like, somebody's wronged you, and you just take that memory, and you just cuddle it, and you kind of hold it close at night, and you just have these like daydreams about how bad that person's been to you. I don't know. Anybody here do this? Because I do this all the time when somebody's wronged me. I love just thinking about what a victim I am and how terrible they were to me and how right I am and how wrong they were. I do this. This is like great therapeutic. Like horribly, horribly masochistically therapeutic, but it's therapeutic. You know, you just remember that and you think about how bad it is. Now, here's the deal. As I hold on to this, what does it do to Kristen? Kristen, I'm going to stare at this rock with as much loathing and anger towards you as possible. Tell me, do you feel anything? Did you feel anything? You didn't. Okay, let me try again. No? No, because it's so interesting. And so often we think like, well, I'm going to hold on to this hurt. I'm going to hold on to this piece of unforgiveness and bitterness, and I'll show them. No? No. Nothing. And here's what we do is we keep all of our rocks in this little bag right here, and it's kind of this, like, collection. I call this relational baggage, okay? And all the hurt from our relationships, every little wrong thing that somebody's done, we just put it on, and we bring this baggage everywhere we go. Now, when I try to be intimate with Kristen, when I say, hey, baby, give me a hug, it's kind of hard because I have this baggage kind of blocking us from being together, right? I mean, it's hard for me to even get close to her. And I know a lot of people, they'll say things like, Pastor, there's an icebox where my wife's heart used to be. An icebox. She's so cold, so cold, so cold, you know? And other people say, my husband's heart is like a heart of stone. And it's not that his heart is hard. It's not that her heart is hard. It's that there's stones of unforgiveness. There's stones of hurt and bitterness that are preventing you from being close to one another, right? And sometimes, I don't know if you've ever seen this, but you go out to eat, and it's like, hey, let's have a date, you know? And then you just set this bag down on the table, and you can't even see each other. You can't even have a conversation with one another. Have you ever seen that? A couple, it looks like, you know, they're young, they should be in love, and you just hear clink, clink, clink. They're just kind of staring down. They can't even look at each other. Maybe you've been on a date where that was your circumstance. Maybe you've been out. Maybe some of you, you're sitting in your seat, and don't elbow, don't do none of that, but you're sitting in your seat right now, and you have this between you. Okay? You're at this series. You're like, this is a chance for us to do something. But you literally have this right now in your relationship preventing you from even feeling close to your spouse. We live in this place, right? Thanks, honey. You can sit down. Appreciate it. Round of applause for Kristen. And what we do is we start to keep those things in our bag of unforgiveness. in our baggage, in our relational baggage. And I'll just give you some examples of some stuff we have. Like, we have this little guy right here. You know, this could be for, you know, the time he bought me a vacuum for my birthday and then forgot about our anniversary, right? That was awesome, you know? And this little guy right here, this is just each one of these little pebbles. This is every time that she's late. It's just like, doesn't seem like a big deal, but she says, John, will you watch your children for an hour? Yeah, sure, baby, I'll watch your children for an hour. Oh, 3 hours later, wow, that was awesome / terrible. Thanks for calling. Oh, you didn't, right? Oh, we're late for church for the 1,000th time in a row, seriously? Doesn't seem like a big deal, but, you know, after a while, they kind of add up, right? And this rock right here, this is for every time I see him in public, engaging, smiling, laughing with other people, but then he comes home, and he can't even find a word for me. He just shuts down in the lazy boy and flips on the TV. Seriously? You're going to zone out? That's what you're going to do? I mean, what kind of relationship? This one here, this is for when he got drunk and he said that he wished he never married me. You know, how can you ever forget that? Like that, that's a word that it's stuck on your heart, right? And this one here, some of you have been through this one before. This is when she said to me that I'm just like my dad. Right, she knows what kind of relationship and how hard that is. These are all hypothetical. This isn't my marriage, by the way, but we've been there. Some of us, some of these are actually for us, but not all of them. And it's hard, right? You have that. Or you could say, hey, this is the one that he threw at me. I can never forget this. When I caught him looking at pornography on the internet. I mean, he told me that he never struggled with that. That wasn't a thing. And here I find out he's been struggling with that since he hit puberty, that he's been doing that. How could I ever open up my heart to him? How could I ever be intimate with him again when I know that he's cheating on me every week with other women, right? And this is the one. She just had her computer open, and I saw a message come up on Facebook, and I picked it up, and it was from her ex-boyfriend from high school. And I read a conversation about how she wished she'd marry him and how she was always satisfied with him but not with me. How could I ever forget that? How could I ever move on from that? How could I ever forgive him for that? I mean, do you understand what that feels like? Do you understand how much that hurts? Here's the rock that I got from when I found out he was cheating on me with a coworker. And how could we ever get over that? I want to forgive him, but this is something that I remember every single day. And I don't want to fantasize about it. I don't want to cuddle with it, but I can't help it. My mind just goes there, and I ruminate on these things. I just think about it. And what we do is we get this collection of rocks in our bag, and they're heavy, aren't they? And it's hard, it's a burden. You know, and we're talking about forgiveness, but honestly, how could I ever forgive? How could I ever move on from these things? I want to see what Jesus has to say about this. It says in verse 19, "For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself." He was fixing broken relationships. No longer counting people's sins against them. Can you imagine that? I mean, this was the part of Christianity that really blew my mind. No longer counting people's sins against them? Really? I mean, that's mind-blowing. How do you even do that? It says, and he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. Somehow he just gives this to us. He gives us this ability. You see, I really believe that Jesus does teach us to restore relationships through forgiveness. And what many of you don't know today, what many of you have taken for granted, I've shared this with some of us before, but Jesus actually invented, as a matter of sociological and historical fact, he coined forgiveness. The idea that you would just look at somebody who'd wronged you and say, even though you didn't ask, even though you don't deserve it, even though I don't want to, I'm going to forgive you. That idea, I'm just going to forget about it, I'm just not going to count it against you, that's a Jesus copyright. That's a Jesus trademark. That's a Jesus thing. I mean, it didn't exist. It wasn't a part of the world until Jesus brought it to the world. That's his thing. And the reason why I think the West has experienced the age of prosperity that it did, the reason why I think we enjoyed this period of civilization growth was because humans were able to forgive other humans, and we were able to grow and prosper amidst the peace that ensued. Jesus invented forgiveness. And here's the thing, I know a bunch of you know where I'm going with this. You know, it's interesting, 2,000 years ago, Jesus taught us about forgiveness, right? And 2,000 years later, most sociologists, a recent study by, I believe that it was Stanford University, but I could be incorrect. I'm having a difficult time remembering. A recent study conducted by a famous university. Golly, John. Okay. But a recent study conducted by a famous university found that the number one restorer of relationships, they could predict marital endurance. They could figure out if a marriage would last to a level of 98% accuracy. The reason why they were able to do this was because they were able to gauge whether or not relationships could practice forgiveness. It didn't take into account race. It didn't take into account finances, backgrounds, nothing. The only thing it looked at is, do couples give and receive forgiveness? And relationships that gave and received forgiveness endured. I know a bunch of you know where I'm going today. You know that I'm going to say, hey, I want you to dump out your bag. But what you're going to say to me is, Pastor, I could never let go of this. This has become a part of who I am. You know what's on me. I mean, I carry this everywhere. I know there's some of you who would say, Pastor, you don't know what's been done to me. Okay? You haven't been a part of my life. I mean, you don't understand what it's like to have your husband come home every day and just be disengaged, to live in the most unloving household possible. You don't know the things that he said to me. You don't know the way that he's embarrassed me. You don't know how unloved I felt for years. There's some of you here today, men, you'd say, man, you don't know what it's like to not have any intimacy, none at all, no connection, to be deprived of your man needs for years. You don't know what it's like to have a wife who is so disrespectful. She humiliates me everywhere I go. You don't understand what this bag feels like. You don't understand how hard it is. It would take a miracle to get this off of me. And here's the thing, I don't know what you've been through. And I know that some of you have been through horrors that are just beyond my imagination. I can't imagine how bad that they are. But I have carried a bag around before in my life. I have. And what I know about my memory is it sort of became an identity for me. It became kind of like the thing that I was. And what it really was I loved being a victim. There's a lot of benefit for being a victim. One of the biggest benefits of being a victim when you carry this around is the comfort of never being in the wrong. Because when you're a victim, when people have wronged you, you just point your finger at other people. That's what you do. You point your finger at other people, because whose fault is it? It's their fault. It's not your fault. And I sort of reached a place where I would have to look for reasons to be offended. You ever have a friend like that, somebody in your life where they just seem like they're literally looking for reasons to be hurt? It's like, come on. And it's not that it feels that way, it's that it actually is that way. Because being a victim is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that we live in. It's a dysfunctional lifestyle that we live in. We just carry this around. And here's what I eventually realized, is that I was carrying this bag around, and what did this actually produce in my life? What does this bag actually produce in your marriage, in your life? I want you to just marinate. Think about this for a moment with me. What is the result of this in your life? What I realized is when I take this bag and I put all my stones on the table, people will look at you and they'll say, oh my goodness, that sounds terrible. I am so sorry. Right? That's what you get. And what is that? That's pity. That's pity. They're giving you pity. And pity is the worst kind of drug. I think it's one of the most addictive, terrible, horrendous drugs that you can have, because there's no high from it. Pity doesn't make you feel good. It doesn't even make you feel better. The only thing that pity makes you want is more pity. It doesn't feel good at all. It's just awful. And I know people who are addicted to pity. You just want more pity and more pity. And here's the other thing about pity, is it ruins friendships. I mean, you have people that you do, you know, things with, but what I really call them, and this is what I found with my bag, is you have friends who are also carrying bags around, and it's sort of like pity conventions, where you go to a restaurant, and everybody just lays their collection of rocks out on the table, and people are like talking over each other, trying to compete for the worst possible story. No, you won't believe what he did to me. You won't believe what she did to me. Here's why my story is worse than yours. Have you ever seen that? And that's not what God intended relationship to be. That's not real connection. That's not real friendship. What I realized this bag gave me was pity and loneliness. And for what? I mean, what was I giving up for that? Here's the deal. When you put this bag down, do you know what you get? You get freedom. You get a burden-free existence. You get love, you get intimacy, you get friendship, you get connection with people. And I'm not hurting anybody but myself by carrying that bag. When I stare at those rocks, when I squeeze those rocks, it's not hurting Kristen. It's not hurting people that I'm mad at. It's only ruining my life. And there's people here today, you're doing this. You're carrying this around. You're living in unforgiveness. And look, I know there's some of you here today. You're like, okay, I get it. I get it, Pastor. I mean, this stinks. You know, it's not good, but I don't know how to put the bag down still. And you haven't helped me with that. And here's how I love the passage ends. It says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us, and we speak. I speak. John Hill is speaking for Christ. When I plead with you today, come back to God. Would you come back to God? See, I just think so often what we do is we try to do this ourselves. We just try to grab onto it ourselves. We try to white knuckle our way through this. We say, well, I can do it. I'll just make it happen. But so often we end up in a place of failure. I would tell you, what if you just came back to God? I think for so many of us, we're realizing maybe for the first time that we've been identifying as a Christian, but we haven't actually been a Christ follower. Do you know that Jesus actually says, he actually says, hey, unless you're forgiving other people, I'm not forgiving you. Like the sure sign of my presence in your life, the sure sign of you being a Christian is you being able to pass forgiveness that I give you to the world around you. If you're living in unforgiveness, you're missing out. Jesus actually says, if you've offended somebody, if you've hurt somebody else, I want you to stop worshiping me. And I want you to go apologize to them. That's how serious he takes it. I just think today that for so many of us, we've been identifying with Christianity, but we actually haven't been following Jesus. I mean, forgiveness is the foundation of freedom. It's the beginning of following Christ. Forgiveness is where it all starts. The final verse of this passage, and this is a summary of the whole Bible, and so it's an incredibly dense and rich verse, but it says, for God made Christ Jesus, who never sinned, who never threw a rock at anybody. We threw rocks at him to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God. Our relationship could be restored with God through Christ. And here's what Jesus does for us, is on the cross when he died, he just takes the bag and he just dumps out all the rocks. It's done. It's over. He says, you don't have to, I'm not gonna carry around that burden. I'm just gonna live in forgiveness. And when he did that for me, when I was 15 years old, when I saw that Jesus just forgave me, when he just let go of that burden for me, I was able to do that for other people. I was able to start admitting that I was wrong. I was able to look at somebody and say, will you forgive me because I've wronged you? For the first time in my life, my eyes were open to my sin against other people because instead of being a victim, I began to gain victory. I began to walk in victory. Here's the reality today. Jesus wants you to come back to him. So as we close, I just want to ask heads to bow and eyes to close, just for privacy and concentration. I know that some of you today, you feel like this whole talk has been just for you. Maybe you've been identifying with Christ, but you've never actually been following the teachings of Jesus. So you've been missing out on the joy of a relationship with God that's been healed. If you're here today and you want to repent of the sin of unforgiveness, if you want to follow Jesus, if you want him to give you the power to forgive other people around you, I'd ask you just to lift up your hand right now as an acknowledgement of God's presence. I see that hand. I see those hands. I see hands going up all over the place now. I see hands. I see hands over on that side. I see hands over on the left side as well. I just think there's something that breaks in the spiritual when we acknowledge God in the physical. Anybody else, just say, you know what? I want to repent my sin of unforgiveness. I just want Jesus' forgiveness to empower me in my life. I see that hand in the back too. I just ask you, those of you who mean business with Jesus, and there are dozens of you, I just ask you to pray in your heart with me right now. Not out loud, but just in your heart. Jesus, I repent of my sin of unforgiveness. I ask you to forgive me and empower me through your forgiveness to forgive other people in my life and to ask for forgiveness where I've wronged other people. I ask you to make me a new person empowered by your love and your freedom today. Today I'm choosing to follow you as my leader and forgiver. In the name of Jesus, I ask and pray these things. Amen. Amen. Can we give a round of applause? There are dozens of people. I'm really proud of what you've done. I've got a next step card in the seat backs in front of you. It says next step, next step, next step, next step on it. If you took a step in your faith today, it doesn't matter what it is. If you took a step closer to Jesus today and you want to know what your next step is, and next step can mean so many different things, but you just say, you know what? I don't want this to be an emotional message. I want it to be a transformational message. I've taken a step today and I want to know what my next step is. I need help plotting that course. I'd ask you to just fill out that next step card, and me or Pastor Isaiah or another somebody on staff will give you a call this week and help you plot that course. But I don't want this just to be an emotional experience. I want it to be a transformational experience. God has more for us. So you can, if you fill that out, you can drop that off at the welcome desk in the back. Now I just ask you to stand, and we're going to wrap up today with a song. I can't wait for the rest of this series, though, church. Don't miss it. I want you to be a part of this, because this is just the foundation, and God has so much more for us. Take it away, guys.